Hey guys, it's Kevin, and this is the iPhone Plus Pro Max Ultra SE. I'm kidding, it's an iPad mini. So my main phone is an iPhone 13 Pro Max at 6.7 inches, and since the iPad mini is 8.3 inches, I wondered if it could replace it. It's pocketable, powerful, and purple. So for the past week, that's what I've been doing, and I learned that it can.
With limits.
So in this video, I'll go over the pros and cons of this iPad mini phone, but first, here's a quick unboxing. I told you it'd be quick. Here's the iPad mini in purple. There are other colors, space gray, pink, and starlight. I'll leave a link to this in the description box below if you want to try out this iPhone Ultra. It has the same squared off size as the iPhone, which makes it easier to hold in one hand. Don't get me wrong though, it's still a two-handed device unless you do some crazy hand shimmying. There's no Face ID, but Touch ID is built in the power button. On the bottom, there's a USB-C port, thank you very much. And this opens up a wide array of accessories you can't connect to on an iPhone. You can plug in an external SSD and access files, or you can connect the camera and import photos. You can even connect an ultrasound. Now the sides are completely flat since the volume buttons are at the top. Apple had to move it there because this iPad mini supports a second generation Apple Pencil, which attaches magnetically to the side. And it's almost the same size as the entire side, so there's no room for volume buttons. It's not as pocketable as an iPhone, but it'll still fit in jacket pockets and smaller bags. As far as design goes, both products are nice. Now moving on to the display. The quality is not bad, but it's not good either. It's 8.3 inches, so about 1.6 inches bigger than the iPhone 13 Pro Max. It also has a new 3:2 aspect ratio, so there's less letterboxing when watching traditional widescreen content. But as someone who uses products that have a 120Hz and OLED or mini LED displays, this is a major downgrade for me. This has an LED display at 60Hz with a max brightness of 500 nits. So I definitely prefer the iPhone's 120Hz OLED screen with a peak brightness of 1600 nits. Okay, the phone part is where things get tricky, and it depends on one of three things. First, if you already own an iPhone, calls and messages appear on the iPad mini, and you can answer or reply directly from it. That's the beauty of the Apple ecosystem. This also includes SMS and MMS from Android, if you're one of those heathens. Second, if you don't have an iPhone, you can still communicate with family and friends if they're in that ecosystem. iMessage works great, as well as FaceTime video or audio calls, and it'll be through an Apple ID. And third, if you don't have an iPhone and your contacts are outside of Apple, then it gets complicated. Since this is a tablet, carriers offer data-only plans, so you won't have a phone number. But there is a workaround. You can install a third-party app such as Google Voice and make all of your calls and texting through there. But even after you figure out which camp you fall in, there's no earpiece, so any phone call can only be done through speakerphone. Although both products have the A15 Bionic, the iPad mini runs at a slightly slower speed. But if I'm being honest, most people can't tell the difference unless you're running a benchmark. And the iPad mini can handle just about any app. Pixelmator Pro, LumaFusion, Clock, so it's not a huge deal. The battery life is good, it can last about the same as an iPhone with normal use. As long as the phone can last at least a day and a half, I'm happy. The iPad mini can now fast charge up to 25 watts compared to 27 watts in the iPhone 13 Pro Max. And as I mentioned before, there's a USB-C Apple, it's okay to have this port. So if you're one charger person like I am, it's one less thing to worry about. The cameras on the iPad mini are okay. There's only a wide angle, so no telephoto or ultra wide. And it's the first camera bump in an iPad mini. It has a 12 megapixel f1.8 aperture compared to f1.5 on an iPhone. It'll still take decent photos in good lighting conditions. Plus, the iPad mini phone doesn't look as silly taking pictures than an iPad Pro. On the front, there's a new 12 megapixel selfie camera with center stage. So if you're in a FaceTime call, the camera will automatically pan around to keep you in the center. Alright, using iPadOS as a phone is a lot better than iOS. Some apps support two columns, so you can see a lot more content on the screen. There's also slide over and split view for multitasking. For example, I can have Safari open on one side, then have Tweetbot open on the other, and have YouTube in a slide over window. It's not ideal in portrait mode, but it's manageable in landscape. The iPhone, on the other hand, is still limited to one app at a time. One downside to iPadOS are the apps that are iPhone only. For instance, Instagram has a lot of letterboxing even if the app is scaled up. And in landscape mode, yeah. Also, the UI looks a lot smaller on an iPad mini. All of the widgets are bigger on iPhone no matter what size it is. The system icons and time are tiny, and the app icons are slightly smaller, but that can be fixed in settings. As a fan of all the bells and whistles in the iPhone 13 Pro Max, this iPad mini phone is not for me. but if it had an OLED screen or mini LED at 120Hz and Face ID, basically an iPad Pro mini, then I'd be tempted to try it again. And that's it for my iPad mini phone experience. If you enjoyed this video, then please like, comment, and subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next one. Bye!